Lord God. A life, Lord God, to be lived for you, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord God, for this day, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for the bread of life that's going to come forth from the man of God, the angel of this house on today. We thank you for the anointing, Lord God, that's on his life, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that you have already put on his heart, his mind. You're going to put on his lips, Lord God, a word for the people on today. We pray, Lord God, that you will help those. Give us an ear to hear what the Spirit has to say today.
Jesus, we just want to thank the Lord for rising, for dying on the cross, and for rising again. Hallelujah. We just want to worship him wherever you are. We ask that you would join in worship as we celebrate our future day. Hallelujah. We don't celebrate as the world celebrates, but we just want to thank the Lord. He didn't have to do it, but he stayed there for our sins. Hallelujah. Oh, we love your name.
our lives. Certainly, we thank the Lord for all of you that are joining us, amen, by the live stream this morning on Facebook or on Periscope. And would you help me celebrate the Lord for the minstrels being in the house on this morning, for the singers, amen, and for the minstrels, amen. We certainly appreciate the Lord for them this morning and everyone in their respective places. To First Lady, y'all, I feel like I'm just right at home right now. Amen. First Lady, and in her absence, she's around here somewhere. We certainly appreciate the Lord for her. And I'm going to go ahead and get right into the word of the Lord. Amen. The Bible declares, amen, that there's nothing new under the sun. And so the word that we have for today should not be a word that is new, but it should be a word of remembrance. Amen. The scripture for today, the word is found in the book of Luke, chapter number 24, looking particularly at verses 1 through 8. And the Bible declares, "Now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulchre, bringing the spices which they had prepared, and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulchre. And they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass that as they were much perplexed thereabout, and behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were afraid and bowed down their faces to the earth, they said unto them, Why seek ye the living amongst the dead? He is not here, but is risen." You need to mark that part right there. He is not here, but is risen. "Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again. And they remembered his words." I want to stop right there. Thus be the reading of the word of the Lord. And the topic that we want to speak from today is actually found in the B clause of verse number 6, when he stated, "Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee." And verse 8 said their response was, "And they remembered his words." Today I simply want to speak to us from this subject: remember what he said. Remember what he said. Lord, do it in Jesus' name. Amen. I must admit, brothers and sisters, that oftentimes I find it amazing, and I amaze myself at how forgetful I can be. As a matter of fact, as I was sitting there and preparing, waiting to come and to mount this sacred desk and pulpit to bring the word of the Lord today, I'm only 44 years old, but I cease to amaze myself at the fact that there are times in which I find myself to be very forgetful. And if the truth be told, there are times in which I have found myself going into the kitchen, amen, to get something, and standing in the middle of the floor for a moment, trying to gather my thoughts and to remember exactly why I'm in the kitchen in the first place. And I can hear some of you all right now saying, "Pastor, you probably have no business in the kitchen at that time then, if you can't remember why you're there in the first place." Well, perhaps I believe that I'm not by myself this morning, and I feel better realizing that I'm not by myself. I must admit that as awkward as it may seem in that moment, I've got to confess that it is even more awkward and more uncomfortable when I have found myself to have forgotten what I should securely know, especially in a moment of crises. As a matter of fact, amen, if the truth were to be told, amen, in those moments of crises and trouble, you would think that I would understand, amen, that it is of utmost importance that I am able to rely on and to lean on what I know. For, amen, I understand that it is by what I know and the strength of God that I am able to navigate, amen, some difficult times in my Amen. When I speak of amnesia, amen, I'm not simply just talking about amnesia as it relates to what I know, but I'm speaking, amen, amen, of amnesia in relationship as to who I am and as to whose I am. And I believe that God would have me to tell somebody here this morning as I get ready, amen, to hurry on through here, that God, amen, would have me to tell somebody this morning, do not let, amen, what you see cause you to forget what he has said. Amen. In other words, we must understand, amen, that God has already spoken about our situations, and sometimes when we look at the current situations and crises that we are facing, sometimes we find ourselves to be forgetful as to what God has already said about our lives. I can hear, amen, the prophet Jeremiah as he began to declare the word of the Lord to the people of God, and he began to declare Jeremiah 29 and 11, amen, that God says, I know my thoughts towards you, said the Lord. Said, these are thoughts of good, amen, and not of evil. In other words, God says, I do not desire to harm you, but I'm trying to bring you to an expected end. Somebody needs to pause right there for a moment in the comment section and just write out there that God has an expected end for my life. Amen. The prophet Jeremiah, no doubt, was in a time in which Israel was in place of captivity and great despondency because of what they were enduring. Amen. But the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah to assure the people of God that God knew exactly what he was doing. Thank you, Lord. Amen. As I began to even ponder this, and I'm speaking theoretically here now, man, I began to find out that there may be three reasons as to why people forget. This is going to help somebody, not just me this morning. Three reasons, amen, potentially why people may forget. Amen. The number one suggested reason as to why people may forget is what is called retrieval failure. One would like to call this the decay theory. In other words, this decay theory essentially speaks to us and suggests to us, amen, that every experience and information that we gather, it seems to leave a memory trace. Amen. And this theory, this decay theory suggests to us that over time, amen, that these memory traces that we now gather and create in our minds will begin to dissipate and disappear if we fail to rehearse and to retrieve them. In other words, I can hear David as he began to declare, thank you, Lord. Hear David now in Psalms chapter number 1. He began to declare, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of the sinner, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. What is there anybody out there that says, Lord, I love thy law? Lord, have mercy. David said, his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law does he meditate. That's a very pivotal word right there, y'all. In his law does he meditate day and night. David says when we meditate on the word of God, we can be assured that we will be strong. Now the word David said, and he shall be like a tree that's planted by the rivers of water. So not only will we be secure and stable, but we'll be able to be productive even in difficult times. Somebody ought to stop for a moment and put your hands together and give God praise. Because as we meditate on the word of God, amen, Jesus began to declare that the words that I speak, they are spirit and they are life. In other words, when we feast on the word of God, my God, it is health unto our neighbor. Thank you, Lord. I got to move on. Number one, reason why we find it difficult to remember is because The second reason why we forget is because of what they call interference theory. And essentially, interference theory tells us that whenever new information or experiences are experienced that are similar to old experiences, they interfere with our ability to retain them. I begin to look at this now. What it says to us now is that older information, it begins to interfere with our ability to recall new information. They have what they call proactive interference. This is where, amen, old memories and old experiences, they make it hard for us to recall new ones. Also having what is called retroactive experiences. Y'all give me just a few more minutes. I'm almost there. They have what they call retroactive interference. Retroactive interference suggests we have new information now. Thank you, Lord. And this new information is making it difficult for me to be able to recall old information. I hear somebody saying, Pastor, where are you going with this here? Well, I find it ironic then that in order to combat whether it is the decay theory, whether it is this theory of interference of information, that we are able to be successful if we simply rehearse the desired information. Y'all ain't listening to me right now. In other words, I want us to understand that if we want to be successful in remembering what Jesus has already said to us, that we've got to make sure, amen, to meditate on the right thing. I can hear the writer now. Thank you, Lord. I can hear the writer now. In Philippians, when he began to declare, he says, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, he says, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, he said, you need to think on these things. In other words, I can hear Paul in Philippians telling the 21st century church, if you want to maintain the peace that Jesus has left unto us all, you can't meditate on the volatility, my God, the flexibility and the liquidity of the stock market or your 401k. But you got to set your eyes, yes, God. You got to set your eyes on the already established word of God. For I hear the writer begin to declare, my God, that the flower faded and the grass withered, but the word of our God, it shall stand forever. I can hear now, y'all. I'm feeling pretty good right now. I can hear now in the book of Lamentation. Thank you, Lord. In Lamentation, he began to declare that this I recall to my mind. He said, therefore have I hope. He said, it's of the Lord's mercy that we are not consumed. In other words, the writer in Lamentation is trying to get us to understand is that we can have hope, and that our hope is directly connected to our ability, to remember what God is saying. In other words, the reason why there are so many hopeless people now, because they're not hoping in God's word. But the writer in Lamentation said, I'm recalling to my mind not only God's word, but my experiences with God. And this new information, which is my current situation, I will not allow it to interfere with what I already know about God. can't get no help out there. I wish somebody say, I've already made it up in my mind. I'm going to follow Jesus. Would you put your hand together now and give God a praise? Thank you, Lord. I'm moving, y'all. I'm almost there. Well, now we see the third and final theory. Theory and reason as to why people, thank you, Lord, they find it difficult to remember. This final theory is called what they call a failure. A failure to store. I'll say that again. It's called a failure to store. In other words, in so many words, thank you, Lord. What it's saying to us, my God, is that our ability or our inability to be able to remember oftentimes is not caused because of a loss of information, but it's lost because rather I never stored the information in my long-term memory in the first place. What are you saying? Thank you, Lord. I'm glad you asked. Yes, Lord. I began to look there. And that was an experiment that was done. And this experiment calls for some test subjects. Amen. To be challenged. Amen. To be able to identify the U.S. penny out of a group of other pennies. Y'all just ride with me for a minute. What they found out is that while those test subjects were able to recall the minor details as to the size, the shape, and the color, there were more intricate details that they were not able to recall because they did not see the more intricate details as being necessary to identify the penny. Thank you, Lord. I can hear y'all right now. Pastor, where you going with this? Well, I need us to understand. Sometimes because we do not understand what it is that God means by what he's speaking into our lives. Sometimes we chalk it up as being insignificant. And we don't pay very close attention to what God is saying. Lord, have mercy. But I need somebody this morning to commit themselves to placing the word of God in their long-term memory. I got to get into this text here. Well, perhaps, brothers and sisters, this is what's going on with the women and the disciples in the text here. We see here in the text, Luke is speaking to us. He begins to speak to us in regards, my God, to their inability to remember what Jesus has said in light of the events that have happened in their last 24 hours. You know what happened in those 24 hours? I'm not going to rehearse them in your ears this morning. But Luke tells us in the text here. Thank you, Lord. He tells us that they rose early. They got up early in the morning, round about sunrise, perhaps. And the Bible declares that the women had gone down to the tomb. They went down there, as was their custom, to anoint the body of our Savior. And the Bible declares that when they got down there, they found that the stone had already been rolled away. Perhaps they had already anticipated that there was going to be interference, there was going to be some challenges. Thank you, Lord. There were going to be some challenges as to their actions. You know how we do, church. Sometimes we've gotten been so used to life being difficult that we don't get up in a new day with a new expectation. But our spirits have been beaten down just like theirs were. And the Bible declares that when they got down there, the stone was rolled away. You know how Jesus does. Somewhere in the middle of the morning, before they were ever even aware, a miraculous event had taken place. I love God. I like how he works, y'all. He works out of the sight of man for the good of man. And I got the testimony this morning that God works best when you go to sleep. Lord, have mercy. The stone rolled away, but the stone was not rolled away for the benefit of Jesus. The stone was rolled away for their benefit, because the Bible declares to us that Jesus had already received this heavenly body. He was in a heavenly form, if you will. Thank you, Lord. He's receiving now this resurrected body. And we've come to understand that the spiritual dimension has no physical boundaries. And so the Bible declares that they go down there. Thank you, Lord. And the tomb is empty. The Bible declares that not only is the tomb empty, but Jesus' body is no longer there. And I would assume that the next verses of the scripture would say that they got out their trap music. They got their band together and they began to praise God for the fulfillment of his word. But the Bible declares that they were perplexed in their mind and didn't understand in their spirit. Well, the Bible declares that Jesus had already risen, and he had risen on the third day, just like he had said. It is significant, brothers and sisters. Thank you, Lord, that we realize that Jesus, he got up on the third day. For the Bible declares now that by him getting up on the third day, he's broken tradition. Because Sabbath, the worship day was on Saturday, which was considered the Sabbath. But Jesus was in the ground on the Sabbath. And there were ceremonial laws that governed how they worshiped and observed the Passover. But Jesus stayed in the grave and got up on Sunday and broke that tradition. He broke it in such a compactful and impactful way that Acts 20 and 7 and 1 Corinthians 16 and 2 tell us that the early church moved their worship day. They moved it from the Sabbath on Saturday and started worshiping on Sunday. Because surely the fact that he rose should give us joy in our soul. I feel like preaching, y'all. Thank you, Lord. I'm almost there. Well, it's significant, y'all, that Jesus rose on the third day, because the Bible declares that he had already told them that I'm going to be in the ground 3 days, and after 3 days I will arise again. Thank you, sir. He said, I will arise again. Well, what this tells me is that we can take comfort in anything that Jesus said, because he got up on the third day. And because he got up on the third day, death no longer reigns over us. For the Bible declares that death reigned from Adam until Moses. But it stopped at Moses, because the law was given. My God, and the Lamb. Lord, have mercy, for the Day of Atonement was given. In other words, a form of grace was introduced in the day of Moses. And our Savior, Jesus Christ, is the fulfillment of the grace that was extended in the Old Testament. He is the manifestation of the totality of God's grace to mankind. But I can hear Titus. I'm getting ready to jump out of my shoes. I can hear Titus when he began to declare that the grace of God, which bringeth salvation, it has appeared unto all men. Somebody ought to thank God for his grace. Come on, give him praise. Give him praise for his grace. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Well, the Bible declares, as I hurry to my close now, well, the Bible declares that not only did he get up on the third day, but when they got there, being perplexed in their mind, the Bible declares that there were two angels there, and the angels spoke these words of hope, for he said, he is not here. Thank you, Lord. Yes, God, he is not here. But check out what they say. He is risen. That caught my attention, y'all. For the angel declared that he is risen. He did not say that he has risen. Not in this text. He said he is risen. Well, sister, I began to look up the word is. And the word is the third person singular, present of the word be. In other words, the word is synonymous with and is interchangeable with the word be. So when the angel says he is risen, he could have said he be risen. Y'all not country like I am. I can remember when they would say in the country, just leave me be. Well, he could say he be risen, or he could say he is resurrection, or resurrection is he. That's what the angel was telling Mary. And I can hear the Bible declare that when the angel tells this to Mary, she began to remember. Thank you, Lord. I suggest to us brothers and sisters, she should have already remembered. Because do you remember when Lazarus died? The Bible declared that Jesus stepped up on the scene. And Mary says to him, Martha, they say to him, they say, Master, if you would have been here, Lazarus would not have died. I can hear somebody in 2020 say, Lord, if you would have been here, I would not have suffered what I have suffered. Lord, if you would have been here, I thought you were with me, Jesus. But if you would have been here, my family wouldn't be in shambles. If you would have been here, my health would not be failing. But I can hear Jesus. He began to say to Mary, he said, do you believe you'll see your brother again? She said, Lord, yes, Lord, I'll see him in the resurrection. And Jesus said to her then, what the angel is reminding of her now, Jesus said, I am the resurrection. I be resurrection. I know that's not proper English, but I need y'all to get it. Jesus said, I am resurrection, and resurrection is me. In other words, the old church put it like this. He specializes in things that seem impossible. Thank you, Lord. in Jesus Christ. Lord, can I say it like this? If Jesus Christ had a middle name, his middle name would be Jesus Resurrection Christ. Lord, have mercy. I know Christ ain't his middle name. I just walk with me. I ain't messing with y'all this morning. It would be Jesus Resurrection Christ. Because you mad, he said now, I am the resurrection. Some of y'all don't believe me, but he is the resurrection. For I can hear the Bible declare. Y'all give me about 4 more minutes. I can hear the Bible declare that he said about us. He said, ye who were dead in trespasses and in sin, hath he quickened and made alive. He resurrected our old dead bodies by the Spirit of his Son, and has now given us life everlasting. Somebody shout hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I got to get out of here. Thank you, Lord. But the Bible declared, yes, Lord, the Bible declared that when they finished hearing from the angel, then they remembered. They remembered what he said. And I just came to tell somebody that you simply need to remember in these terrible times. You need to remember just what he told us. You need to remember that Jesus already told us that I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'll be with you until the end of the world. You need to remember that Jesus already told us. Thank you, Lord. He's already told us, lo, I'll be with you always. He's already told us that in this world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. And greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Somebody shout, he's already told us. You need to remember that he told us that I'm going to prepare a place for you. And where I go, where I am, you may be also. In other words, one day I'm going where Jesus is. And I can hear my grandmama now. She said, one day I'm going where the wicked shall cease from troubling and the weary. And all of the saints of the ages gonna sit at his feet and be blessed. I am remembering. I've got to remember that he's already told us in his word that many are the afflictions of the righteous. But the Lord, yes, Lord, he will deliver. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Tell your neighbor, you got to remember. You got to remember. Yes, Lord. You got to remember. Remember what he's told you. Thank you, Lord. Remember what he's told you. Remember what he's told you in his word, that he's going to see us through. He's already told us for these light afflictions. I'm getting ready to cut this thing off, but I'm just trying to remind somebody to remember what he told us. He already told us that many are the affliction of the